Now, at the core of Photoshop is layers and our layers panel. If we don't know what we're doing with layers, we do not know how to use Photoshop. In fact, many people that are trying to learn Photoshop, their biggest hurdle is understanding what layers are and how they work. So I'm gonna introduce you guys to what I call my layer theory. And we're gonna talk about what layers are in a theoretical sense, and then we're gonna jump into Photoshop and I'll show you what they are in a practical sense. But imagine with me real quick that I gave you an original Picasso worth tens of millions of dollars, and you're hanging that on your wall, and you sit there and you're bored one day, and you think, man, I would really love to take this Sharpie and just draw on that Picasso. Now, would you? Some of you are saying yes. Some of you, though, most of you, hopefully are saying no. You wouldn't, right? It would completely deface this priceless piece of artwork. But what if along with that Picasso, I gave you guys a bunch of clear glass panes, the exact same size as the Picasso, and they were as clear could be. In fact, they looked invisible. Well, couldn't you then just go and take one of those glass panes, stack it on top of the original Picasso, and then take your Sharpie and begin to draw, maybe a mustache or a funny eyebrow. And then let's say you wanted to continue that process. Well, you could go back to that closet of all the glass panes, pull out a next one, layer it on top, and keep drawing and keep drawing and keep drawing. These are layers. Clear, transparent objects that when placed on top of your existing document inside of Photoshop are completely invisible. They make no change visually to your project, but now you can begin to add things to them without altering the information underneath. And it's critical to think of them this way, because let's say that you laid down one of these glass panes on your Picasso and you just start going to town. 3 hours go by, 6 hours go by, 9 hours go by, and you just have been working on the one pane of glass. Well, now a friend comes over and starts admiring your work, and then they bump you, and you mess up, and all of a sudden now that one glass layer that you've been working on is messed up. Well, what do you have to do? Remove that glass pane, but what goes with it? Everything you've been working on. And now you have to grab a new pane of glass and start over. But what if you did a separate pane of glass for every single feature you wanted to add to your Picasso? Well, then your friend comes over and bumps you, but you've only been working on one small component to your greater project. So now when you throw that glass pane away, you're not set back 6 hours, you're maybe only set back 5 minutes. This is how layers work. They're clear, and you can stack them on top of each other and add different information to the different layers. But there's also a different component about layers that are important to note. They work in what I call a top-down mentality. If I give you guys a deck of cards and have you flip over the top card, well, which one can you see? Obviously the top one. But does that mean that all the other cards beneath it fail to exist? No, of course not. It just means you can't see them. They're covered underneath this top card. So is true with layers in the layers panel. If we have 600 layers of a project, and we make a brand new layer at the very top, and we fill that with solid black, what are you gonna see now? Solid black. Doesn't matter what's beneath it. What matters is that top layer. It's a top-down mentality. And I mention this now because a lot of times we'll start working and when we're new to Photoshop, we'll accidentally make a solid color layer at the top. And we panic, like, oh no, I've erased everything I've done. Now it's just solid black. But it's not. Top-down mentality. If you erase that top black layer, what's underneath it? Everything you've been working on. So that's layer theory. That sets up, on a fundamental level, how layers function in Photoshop. So let's head into the program and I'll show you what it means there. When our artboard first launches, I want to draw your attention to the very top tool in our toolbar. It's called the Move tool. And this is kind of the foundational tool of all of Photoshop. If we ever want to move something around in our artboard, we have to have the Move tool selected. Now, because I'm a huge fan of keyboard shortcuts, I want to ease you into them slowly. But for the Move tool, it's absolutely critical because anytime we have a different tool selected, we always want to jump right back to the Move tool to move things around. So V on the keyboard, V as in Velcro, allows us to access our Move tool with ease. Now, because there's nothing in our artboard to move, every time we click and drag, it just creates a bounding box, nothing exciting happening there. And notice over in our artboard one, in our layers panel, we have layer one, and it is transparent because of the checkerboard background. What I want to do is I want to create a two-layered composition so we can get used to the Move tool and get used to how layers work. Now let's select layer one in our layers panel. When you select a layer, it turns light gray as opposed to the dark gray. Select layer one, and let's come over to our toolbar and I'll introduce you guys to another tool. Now I like to start right here smack dab in the middle, not with the gradient tool, but if you click and hold or right click it, you see the paint bucket tool. Now I like starting with the paint bucket tool because honestly, we've all used a paint bucket tool in some way, shape or form, whether in Microsoft Paint or any other digital painting program, the paint bucket tool is pretty simple to use. So let's go ahead and select it. Now with the paint bucket tool selected, we have some options. Look down here at the bottom of your layer panel. We see two squares, a black square and a white square, one on top of the other. We see a miniature version of that in the upper left and a right degree arrow to the upper right. This is called our color picker window and our foreground and background colors. This little area is very important because when we have a color-oriented tool selected, like the paint bucket tool, it's always going to fill or paint or draw with the foreground color, the top square here. So right now, if I were to simply click inside of my artboard, it paints in black. Why? Because the foreground color is set to black. Now I'm going to go ahead and undo this, and to undo, we just simply hit Control Z, or Command Z if you're on a Mac. Now let's choose a different color for our foreground and background colors so we can have some fun colors for our layers. To change the color, we simply click on the square that we want to change. In this instance, I'm going to select black. And when we click on the color, our color picker window comes up. Now, the color picker window has two main features. The main square here, which is our shade of color. And we can click and drag our mouse inside of it to choose a shade. And the hue slider over here to the right. Now, the hue is the color family. So when I grab these two arrows down here at the bottom and drag it up, it's changing the hue or the color family that then we can go inside of our shade window and choose the exact shade of. You have to adjust both to change the color. Now notice down here we have a bunch of scary bubbles with a whole bunch of random numbers. But based on our lecture, the Image Basics lecture, we know now that RGB stands for the red, green, and blue values of this particular color. And CMYK is a percentage of black. So if we look at this then, the red, green, and blue colors, we understand now what this is saying. On a scale from 0 to 255, this particular shade of blue is 25 red, 195 green, and 244 blue. Now we also talked about the hex number, the hexadecimal number for individual colors. For this shade of blue, we have a hex number down here. And these hex numbers are wonderful because you can select them and send them to any designer anywhere in the world, and they will paste this into Photoshop and they will get this exact same color blue. So go ahead and choose a color, any color you'd like here in the color picker window, and then simply hit OK. Notice now how our foreground color is blue. Now let's hit this little arrow right here. This toggles between our foreground and background color. So let's make our white square the foreground. And then let's select it. And change our color to something else. Once you have a color that you like, go ahead and hit OK. So now I have two unique colors, my blue and my kind of lime green there. Now, if you ever want to reset your colors back to black and white, true black and true white, there's this tiny little icon right here to the upper left of your color picker window. It looks like a black and white square just as we found it. And if you click on that, it defaults your colors back to black and white. I'm going to go ahead and bring back my green and my blue. I can now use, depending on which color is the foreground, I can use that color to fill with my paint bucket tool. So I'm going to choose blue first. With layer 1 selected in our artboard, I'm going to simply click my paint bucket tool in my artboard, filling it, the entirety of it, with blue. Now let's talk about layers. Now this is a one layer composition. We only have the first layer. So if I come up and I grab my move tool, again, the very top tool on the keyboard, V if you want the keyboard shortcut, and I click and I drag or I move my layer 1, what should we see behind it? Nothing. Nothing. Because there's nothing underneath my layer. Now some of you might be thinking, well, I see white underneath it, not nothing. Photoshop likes to default the background to white, even though it is transparent or nothingness. And we can see this if we click on the word Artboard 1 in our Layers panel. It takes us to our Artboard Properties up here in the Properties panel. And we can see here that our preset is indeed set to the Web Large, and that our Artboard Background color is set to white. If you click on this, you can change it to transparent, and now indeed we can see that there is nothing behind layer 1. So if I select layer 1 again, you can see now there's nothing truly behind it. Now I'm going to hit Control Z and bring back layer 1 to match the boundaries of my artboard. Now I want to create a second layer, which means we have to learn how to make new layers. It's really quite easy, and it's a mantra that I'm going to repeat all semester long through these tutorials. Let's go up to Layer in the menu bar. Layer, New, very top side menu, Layer. Layer, New, Layer. Layer, New, Layer. Say it with me. Layer, New, Layer. The faster you guys understand going to that menu item and hitting New and hitting Layer every time you want to make a new layer, the faster your workflow will become. Now select that and the new layer dialog box pops up. It says layer 2 is the default name. Don't worry about anything under here. We will get to all these settings in unit 4. So let's go ahead and just hit OK. Now, nothing visually changed in our artboard. It's still blue. Why? Because if you think back to our Picasso example, we've added a clear pane of glass on top of our blue layer. And we can see this over here in our layers panel. We see layer 2 stacked on top of layer 1, and the thumbnail is the checkerboard pattern, which is transparency. So nothing should have changed. So with layer 2 selected, again, you can select between your layers. With layer 2 selected, let's go over to our paint bucket tool again. And let's change our colors here with this little arrow to change our background color to our foreground. For me, that's the green. And let's now click on our artboard again. Now, some of you may have just panicked. You thought, oh no, I overwrote my blue. You didn't. Look over in your layer panel. We see the green now on the layer 2 thumbnail, and our blue is still there. But where is it? Underneath layer 2. And this takes me back to my top-down mentality concept that I talked about earlier. Because layer 2 is a solid green, we're going to see it over layer 1. We're not going to see any blue unless I come up to my move tool and I simply move layer 2. Now we're actually seeing the physical layer, and now we're seeing the layer underneath it. There's another way we can do this. I'm going to hit Control Z back until my green layer fills the entire artboard. Look over in our layers panel. You should see these eyeball icons on any layer you ever make, period. These eyeball icons allow us to toggle on or off the visibility of that particular layer. So if I wanted to turn off my green layer to see my blue layer, I just click the eyeball. And if I turn it back on, there it is. Now if I turn the eyeball off for my blue layer, nothing changes. Why? Because the green layer is currently on top. Even though indeed, if I move this, I am turning on and off my blue layer. So use those eyeballs. They're very handy if you're working with a lot of layers and you want to be able to see through some of them just to make sure that things are the way they're supposed to be, or that you didn't accidentally change something. But this is how layers work in Photoshop. I'm going to go ahead and hit Control Z a few times to bring my green layer back to the size of my artboard. Now let's look back over to our layers panel. What if I wanted to rename my layers? Now, naming layers is absolutely critical because notice how it names them layer 1, layer 2, layer 543. That's not going to help as we start to build complex compositions. We need to be able to name our layers to be exactly what's on them so we can easily select between them. Now, changing a layer name is really easy. You simply double click where it says layer 1 or layer 2. If I double click layer 2, I can change this to say green. And then click off of it. Now double click layer 1 and change that to be whatever color you have on layer 1. For me, that's blue. Now I name my layers absolutely silly things sometimes to help me remember what's on it. So there's no right or wrong thing to name a layer, so as long as you remember what it is when you go to click on it. Now, what if we want to erase a layer? What if I want to just get rid of my green layer completely so I can just see my blue? Well, go ahead and select the layer you want to erase. Now, there's two ways we can erase a layer. There's actually more, but I'm going to teach you guys two ways. The long way and the short way. The long way is to come down here to the trash can icon at the bottom of your layers panel. It says delete layer. When you click that, it asks you, do you want to delete this green layer? Well, yes, I do. Now it's gone, leaving just the blue. Now if you just erased your layer, go ahead and hit Control Z, and let me show you guys the short way, or the way that I prefer at least. The reason why I don't like just clicking the trash can icon is because if I accidentally have a layer selected that I didn't realize, I'm going to erase that layer without potentially knowing it. And with two layers, that's not a great risk, but once we start to get into 20 layer compositions, that can be kind of a scary thing just to randomly hit that trash can icon. What I like to do is grab my actual layer that I want to erase, in this case green, and I can physically drag it to the trash can. And when I let go of my mouse, it erases it. Now the reason I like that is because it takes an extra degree of intentionality. My brain can process what layer I'm dragging to the trash can as I'm dragging it. It helps keep me from erasing layers that I don't want to erase. Now I'm going to go ahead and hit Control Z to bring back my green layer. So this helps us now understand layer functionality, as well as our first two tools, the Move tool and our Paint Bucket tool. We also learned how to rename our layers, make new layers, erase a layer, and how to change our colors in our color picker window. So hopefully now you guys have a good idea of how layers work in Photoshop. They are absolutely critical for us to move forward in this program well.